All right. Should we start? All right. Welcome everyone. Thanks for coming. This will be talk about packaging Chromium with some focus on Fedora. If you have any questions during this talk, there'll be Q&A at the end, but also feel free to just interrupt and ask during the talk. My name is Paweł Hajdan. Let's see, what should we start with? So Fedora was the first Linux distro I installed. So that kind of motivated me, you know, to come to this conference, present a talk about Chromium, where I'm a committer. So I'm trying to make things better in this area. Okay. So this is fresh news. Chromium has been accepted into Fedora just a couple days ago, and so I thought I would start, you know, with this, because this was almost going to be like, why is Chromium still not in Fedora? But now things have actually changed, and that's very nice. So I'm going to talk later a little bit more about, like, why is it a non-trivial package to include, why it took a bit long, and it's been a lot of work. So thanks for that. I'm actually really glad, you know, this happened. And actually, it might not be that easy to keep that package up to date. So let's see, you know, how it works going forward. This is going to be very similar to my LinuxCon talk 2 years ago. And one of the goals, it's not so much about, you know, any information or kind of things, like they change very quickly, and you will see that later. My main goal here is actually, you know, get people to work together, get these communities. You know, there is Chromium is mostly developed by Google, and there are other companies contributing as well. There are individual contributors, but largely, you know, it's been started by Google, and so then there is the open source community, the wider one, the Fedora, Linux, you know, all of that, and I would like, you know, these two communities to work together. Like, ideally, they should be kind of, you know, the same community. Part of, you know, what we're trying to do, we're using Chromium.org addresses for day-to-day development. Like, we see ourselves more as Chromium developers, basically. And the idea is to create a very inclusive, you know, group. We also often need some changes in other open source packages, say libUSB or Hanspel. And this is not always so easy, right? So the basic idea is we just need to work together. We cannot say, oh, these Chromium guys produce something which is hard to package, or these Fedora guys have some, you know, really hard guidelines, and, you know, why do they have these restrictions about bundled libraries? No, we need to, you know, talk, understand, and figure out solutions. And so far, this has been fairly successful, but I'll go on more details later. Also, to start, well, do you know where this is from? That's the comic that came out in 2008, first public Google Chrome release. And I really like reminding people about this, like our roots are open source. People who created Chrome had a strong Mozilla background, and they were earlier contributing to Mozilla. And so it all started with the thought that, okay, all of this technology is going to be open source, we're going to be a good citizen, we'll actually, you know, help other people develop better browsers, have, you know, use this really, help us change. To a large degree, this is happening. And I think I would like to encourage even more of that. I actually created this slide today because I was talking to people on this conference and realized that the scale of Chromium is not so obvious to everyone. I actually work on it day to day. But to give you like a sense of scale, I counted over 3,000 contributors. You know, the compressed sources, the tarball is over 400 megabytes. I won't read all of these numbers, but just some highlights. You know, we have several millions lines of code. Now there is this. We use over 200 third-party packages, and we check them in because on Windows, where we also ship, there is no concept of system dependencies, so we have to bundle them. And there is like over 200 of these packages. Think about that. So that means, you know, on this scale, we're kind of like a mini distro, some degree even, which creates interesting challenges for us. And then, you know, on all that scale, we do a stable release every 6 weeks. And we see over 200 commits every day. I'm actually working on a team which creates infrastructure for this and kind of keep it running. You know, when we have an outage, we kind of lose productivity, 200 patches a day. It's really challenging. I put the slide at the beginning when people still pay attention, but here are some suggestions. You know, I don't like and I don't intend too much to tell people what to do, but I was watching how, you know, the Chromium Fedora package was kind of developed and all of the difficulties with that. And I also saw successes, you know, elsewhere, like what works, what doesn't work. These are the suggestions I came up with. And the first one is, have a team. Okay, so it's not like a simple package you're going to compile, you know, in 5 minutes on your laptop. I mostly package Chromium for Gen 2. This is actually a Gen 2 laptop, by the way. But you know, we have a team in Gen 2 of about like 5 people just for that one package. The way we work, I usually focus on dev channel releases, which come out roughly weekly. And almost every week, there is some breakage. Like, I need to make non-trivial changes to the package to make it compile, to make it work. Actually, it's mostly about compile, so it's easy, right? If it compiles, it is perfect. But then other team members, you know, help with things like beta channel bumps, stable channel bumps, when there is a security update. I don't need to worry about that. I can focus on the hard parts. They help out with like bug trash, do the bugs reproduce. It's really, really, and you know, it's the best factor. When I go on vacation or something happens, you know, we just have other people. We can discuss our ideas. We can, you know, it's really, really helpful to know that it's not just me who does everything, right? And that's also encouraging. You know, there is every distro has a room for this. There is a need. Like, if you're looking for ways to contribute, to do something, I encourage you to join like a Chromium team or whatever. I don't know how it's going to work for Fedora, but I wish there was a Chromium team eventually. Because every small task, I'm very sure is going to be helpful. I saw a bug queue of, say, Ubuntu Chromium bugs. Like, they have a lot of bugs reported against Chromium. Same for Debian. I actually didn't see Fedora, but the official Chromium package is only a couple days old. But, you know, over time, the bug queue itself might be, you know, might need help managing. And then the next thing is, well, limit amount of custom patches you apply, right? The package I maintain has about 5 custom patches, and it's going to be down to 4 next week, I hope. I just need to like upstream one of them. I think the current Fedora package has around 15. I'm not sure about the exact number. But at some point it becomes really unmanageable. I'll mix these points a little bit, but there is this thing. I have a really fast machine which compiles Chromium in 30 minutes. But say on this laptop, it takes 5 to 7 hours. I should actually have measured it, but you know, a couple hours basically. So when you're iterating on packaging, I mean, I obviously recommend when you're iterating, have just a checkout and use given release, working that checkout and do incremental builds. But when you do packaging, you probably won't do a clobber build eventually. So that's going to take a long time to make sure it all works. And in general, you know, when you have to rebase your patches and recompile, it's a really bad cycle. And basically, when you saw we had 200 patches every day, that also means upstream is moving very fast. So if the more non-trivial patches you have, it might be a nightmare, you know, to try to rebase them. And there is also a culture of things about the Chromium project that, you know, we move things around pretty freely. Like, it's not like, oh, this code is here, so it stays here. No, we have like 2 or 3 big refactoring efforts going on, where they're actually kind of, you know, when you see a stack of components, they're actually kind of wrapping it around the other way, make them more flexible, and it's kind of scheduled for like 2 or 3 years. And so things can change in the code base quite radically. It's really best if people can upstream the distro patches once, you know, it's just like the Linux kernel. Once you get your patch upstream, you don't need to rebase it. It's pretty much there. And in practice, it works for me. You know, my packaging experience was that generally these patches just stay upstream. Occasionally something new comes up, so there is temporarily new patch in my package, but then I go upstream that patch. It works very well in practice. I already mentioned packaging dev channel releases, not just stable releases. And again, the idea is you deal with a smaller number of breakages at given time, right? 1 week, that's about like say 1,000 commits, right? So that's manageable. And usually you have like 1 or 2 breakages every week. You can deal with that kind of incrementally, okay? But imagine now, like, stable release, which is 6 times that, now you get a lot of more issues. There is usually more pressure because there is like a security update, compiles takes you a couple of hours. People might just burn out if they try to do that for too long. So, you know, that's another suggestion. Another good thing is we've created a mailing list called Chromium Packagers at Chromium.org. The idea is to have a place for, you know, Chromium packagers from various distros and also Chromium community members who are interested in helping out in having a high quality Linux packages to discuss issues. Like if someone found, oh, you know, build with this system library broke, and here is the solution. You know, other people can just reuse that solution versus like repeating the same debugging process every time. And you can look at the archives. Historically, a lot of issues are very common. So the idea is, you know, I don't want to get into like dev versus RPM or anything like that. That's going to stay probably, right? But what I mean is like at a higher level, there are things that we can hopefully only solve once, and then, you know, packagers can adapt. Okay, this is the way in our package, that's how we apply that fix, but at least you know what to do. So I encourage that. It's not strictly for packagers. Anyone can join, anyone who's interested. or you can just look, you know, what's being discussed. Then there is this. Actually, that's another fairly exciting thing. I tested this yesterday. Just yesterday. Now there are no set UID bits required for Chrome sandboxing to work. This has been tested with M54 currently in the dev channel. So in about 12 weeks, this should make it to stable. And there are a couple of kernel config options needed to get this to work, mostly namespace support. Security YAML is recommended. I think it's not strictly needed. I just put it here for completeness. The idea is like if Chromium will refuse to start if the sandbox doesn't work for some reason. So it's really easy to test. And there is one caveat that this won't work inside chroot. So I actually had to use my laptop to test this because in chroot, you know, the only way to sandbox is still setuid binary. Then I'm going to talk a little bit about the solution that made unbundling libraries easier. And I'm really glad Fedora started using this. You know, I just believe that solutions are only good when people start using them, right? That means they're useful. It was created in 2013 after various discussions with the Chromium community. You know, basically the idea is we need some switches or changes to the build system to enable build with system libraries. And the Chromium community didn't like these conditionals. Like there was a different code path for various things, right? And they didn't know what's going on. Like typical Chromium developer doesn't necessarily know about, say, PKG config or other things that are, you know, like just daily things for Linux developers, right? So it was kind of confusing for them. The idea was, okay, let's create another directory tree, put everything there, so that they don't need to look at this, but there would be very useful bits shared by the Chromium packagers. And that's another thing. Like contributions to that are welcome. Files are fairly small, and I will shortly describe what's inside. Well, first is a little script called remove bundled libraries, which removes bundled libraries, obviously. Tricky part is the list you see is not the list of things to remove. It's the list of things to keep. And removes everything else, which has third party in the name. Well, actual list wouldn't fit on this slide. It's over 100 lines of various exclusions. Something to note is that you can, in that source tree, there is up to like 3 levels deep nesting of third party directories. So in the last example, in red, you can see it's like third-party traceware, third-party TVCM, third-party polymer. Okay, so there is this weirdness thing, and the script actually removes everything not explicitly whitelisted. So you know, it's not enough to have an exclusion just for the top-level third-party traceviewer. It will still remove third-party directories down there. So the idea is, it guarantees you have a consistent list, you know, of third-party code that's still kept bundled. And actually, if any of these entries is stale, if some of these directories have been deleted from the source code, it will also fail. And so the idea is, you know, your package will create very accurate lists so that just looking at your package, you can see all of the bundled code. Okay. And another tricky thing with Chromium, I'm not sure if any other project is doing this, but again, this is somewhat special. Shim headers. The Chromium style of including headers, that's actually from one of the CC files. It has this double quotes and refers to a PNG header with third-party prefix, right? And the idea is we actually can't change that line in the CC file because the Chromium community is opposed to that. Like, we will need to have conditionals, or we will need, you know, like when you build Chromium bundled, you want to use the same headers and the same sources, right? When you mix headers and the library you link to, bad things happen, right? So they don't want that either. And it's very obvious when you use double quotes that you're using the bundled version. But for the distro build, we want to do the opposite, right? And so what can we do about this? Long time ago, distros used to have these giant patches just changing all the occurrences, you know, of includes to use the system header. But it's not sustainable. Like, these patches are huge and they're really hard to rebase. So instead, after some discussions, and again, this was actually a suggestion from one of the Chromium people with Mozilla background, we found a solution that's acceptable to both packagers and Chromium community. And so what we do, we generate shim headers. We recreate the expected third-party directory structure inside the build output directory. We put a png.h header there, and what it does, it includes the real png.h. It works. And again, the idea is it just doesn't require any changes to the mainline Chromium files. It's kind of like totally separate and just works. So I thought it's like a nice, clever, you know, solution that normally would be overly complex, but, you know, we have like various requirements here, right? That's why we do this. Well, then there is this. And if what you see on the screen is cryptic and unreadable, it really is. That's the point. JIP was the previous build system used by Chromium. It actually replaced Visual Studio's cons and Xcode files checked into the sources. So you can imagine, especially with Xcode, you know, it was very difficult doing cross-platform development when platform-specific IDE config files were checked into the repo. So when you were adding a file, it's relatively easy to modify scons and Visual Studio. That's just an XML file, so you could figure it out. But Xcode was particularly hard to just add a file to the build system. So the idea with JIP was, you know, people created something that's just like a Python directory list syntax, and they came up with this kind of least common denominator for all of the three big IDEs, and then JIP generates, you know, dynamically the files for your build system. But as you see here, it's kind of cryptic. Like, there's also a poor documentation for JIP. Editing of those, you know, when you got to like fifth or seventh level of nesting, it was really hard. It was actually hard for Chromium people working on those day to day. And especially so, you know, if you were like a Chromium packager, mostly familiar with AutoTools, for example, right? I mean, AutoTools are not pretty either. They're actually very ugly. But at least people are used to them, right? And they're documented. But this thing is very Chromium specific. So a very common complaint I've heard from packagers was that, hey, look, like, I don't know how to work with this, even to like add a compile flag, add a file. You know, these are the things you actually do when packaging. This is being now replaced with GN. That's a new system. GN stands for Generate Ninja, and Ninja is a make replacement that the Chromium project uses. It's faster. By the way, Ninja is really cool. If you want to make notes, check it out. And as you see, this syntax is actually cleaner and nicer. It might still be different, but there is extensive documentation. I'm actually going to mention on the next slide there is documentation for it. It's generally simpler. You can understand more just by looking at the examples. There's one thing, GIP used to be in Python. GN is in C++. So when you package Chromium to use GN, you need first to bootstrap GN. And there is a Python script for that. Sometimes bootstrapping breaks, and the script needs to be up-labeled. It still doesn't support CFlags and the other variables like CC or CXX. I'm working on that. And so we should have things working in the next few weeks. Meanwhile, you know, it might require either patches or something. And then what have we unbundled? This is mainly a list I took. These are kind of like non-trivial libraries that require changes to the build system. libpng, libxml, zlib, notably ffmpeg. It's been pretty successful. You know, I think the like ffmpeg libav fork kind of calmed down. It's all ffmpeg back, so it also helps simplify things. There is one custom patch you need to apply to use system ffmpeg, and I think it should be possible to work with ffmpeg community to not to require that patch. Basically, they're keeping some. You know, Chromium is using some internal data ffmpeg data structures in one place, and system ffmpeg doesn't expose these headers. So we could work with ffmpeg to just expose the functionality that Chromium needs. Some interesting ideas, like what we might do in the future, and the actual list is much longer. And probably includes things I didn't think about, but these are, you know, something I came up with, like, what could we do, right? Beyond just compiling something, right? Well, we could unfork Hanspel. Chromium has some changes to Hanspel. Last time I gave this talk, I said, hey, look, Hanspel is really terrible. They still use CVS, and so no wonder people, you know, find it hard to contribute to Hanspel. It's now on GitHub. Pull requests are getting accepted, and so hey, if anyone is interested, you know, I think it's going to be much easier to get any patches to Hanspel. Chromium people actually won't go out of their way to like get these patches. Like, you know, bundled copy of Hanspel works in Chromium, and so, you know, then there is like Mesa Kronos headers. We could get them more in sync. Last time, the issue was mainly some discrepancy on 32-bit, and also handling extensions with G. So we needed some changes to the build process. It actually worked for a while, but was fairly complex. So we might give it another try with GN. Should be simpler now. Also, you know, there is like I think there are new iterations on OpenGL. So anyway, I'm mostly highlighting things here. Re-enabling system SQLite, that's another one. SQLite doesn't want to make all the changes that we would like them to make to work inside the sandbox, so it's pretty challenging. Then there is, you know, system lib SRTP doesn't work inside Chromium sandbox. It requires on it depends on boring SSL modifications. That's like an open SSL fork. And so again, this is like, you know, we have a fork in the community. There's open SSL, there's boring SSL, there's libre SSL, and like, well, okay, what do we do, right? How do we keep this all compatible? That's a challenge to the wider open source community that Chromium project itself isn't going to solve. And if you solved this, I guess it would be much easier, you know, to make this all work inside Chromium Sandbox. Fix and build with system ICU. It broke at some point and just needs work. PDE fume bundles. Here's the thing. How many of you know what PDE fume is? No one. All right. How many of you know about the PDF viewer inside Google Chrome?
Yeah.
All right. So it used to be closed source. For at least a couple of months, it's fully open source. And it's called PDFium. So it's a package. It's based on Foxit code base. And it's available as open source part of Chromium. So generally, our Chromium packages now should have PDF viewer out of the box. It just has some bundled libraries that don't have to be bundled. We're enabling system protobuf for Chromium. And then, you know, crash reporting. I saw distros have some kind of crash reporting mechanisms. And Chrome also crashes. I don't know how often it crashes for you, but it certainly does crash for distros. And some of these crashes might be distro specific. So a possible idea for the distant future might be, okay, let's figure out how to connect, you know, the distro crash reporting mechanism to the Chromium crash reporting thing. Because Chromium uses the multiprocess architecture, so you know a renderer might crash or some other background process that it uses, and I'm not sure if the distro crash reporting you know catches that if it properly symbolizes things, especially that these processes are often running inside the sandbox, so you know that's mostly throwing the idea out there. It's certainly a huge non-trivial project. And then we're getting close to the end of the talk and to the Q&A. I would like to kind of reiterate that you know contributions to the Chromium project are very welcome. These are like the top domains of contributors. I took these stats yesterday, so they're you know very up to date. Most of them you see are Googlers, and then there is a lot of Gmail addresses, which are probably individuals, and this is great. And then there is, you know, actually when you look at the number of people contributing from each of the other companies, like, hey, this, you know, this is amazing to me. I'm actually very, you know, very happy to see that, you know, people are kind of investing so heavily into those, and this includes Blink, which is like fork of WebKit. So you know there are some people and companies that focus on say the HTML engine, and that's also great. That's all fine. That's all part of Chromium, and Chromium is also included in Qt or Qt, whatever you pronounce it. So it ends up also on Linux, you know, systems as a library, and contributing to Chromium might be a way, you know, to improve things there. Right, another thing, and I hope it will be very interesting. One of the concerns I heard about contributing to Chromium was, oh, you need to sign the CLA. And yes, we're very strict about this. We do have automated checks that you've signed a CLA. Either individual or corporate. Actually, here is the thing. I'll mention it later. Anyway, it's not a corporate assignment, and as far as I can tell, it's very similar to Fedora Project Contributor Agreement. So if you're okay with the Fedora Agreement, I hope you'd be okay with the Google CLA. If anyone isn't, I'm actually very interested, you know, in talking to people like what their concerns are about contributing to Chromium. What are the barriers? How can we, you know, make that process easier, basically? Because I know, you know, we have a lot of people who only contribute one patch, for example, and that's great. I wish, you know, it was even easier to contribute to Chromium. Like there is like, you know, a huge code base to download. It's several gigabytes. Of code, it takes a lot of time to compile, so by itself that's a barrier, but if there are any other things we could remove, that's great, right? And by the way, sometimes people might think, oh, you know, my use case is too weird, or why would the project accept my changes? I actually went through and I looked for these kind of like weird, you know, things that got upstreamed, and I've noticed, you know, some support for FreeBSD, OpenBSD, Solaris, AX, QNX, actually, MIP, SparkC, S390. Many of these things are not for Chromium itself, like entire Chromium, like who would run, you know, browser on the mainframe. Probably doesn't make sense, but in V8, which is the JavaScript engine, they actually do have support for some of these architectures. Mm-hmm. And it's not developed by Google. It's developed, you know, it's been contributed by people who actually use this code in these environments, and it got accepted. So it's possible. There's also Wayland, Ozone. They kind of have some parts in the Chromium code base itself, and they have their own repo and a way to, like, you know, combine the two. It can work. And a lot of time the barrier is, you know, you need someone to review your changes, you need someone to help you, you know, make your changes in a way that's suitable for inclusion in upstream. You need kind of like a reputation that you will be around to fix things if needed, especially for larger changes like, you know, architecture support, right? People do not want to, like, have something that will be dead code too soon, I guess. But it's manageable. And I think for, you know, for small changes, like fixing a bug, fixing something there, nobody's going to, like, ask you to, like, stay around or, like, maintain your line of code. It's mostly for, like, larger changes, right? When people come to the project and they say, I want to make large changes, I think it's reasonable for that project to also say, okay, but, you know, we'll support this, right? I think that's been the biggest barrier for any, you know, larger... Unbundling was one of these changes, and the solution we found was actually, okay, there will be nothing to support because we're going to live in a completely different place, right? And that said, you know, again, I think it's mostly about, you know, saying, okay, you know, Chromium is open to contributions working, you know, with Fedora community, any other community, and encouraging people to, like, you know, ask, participate in that process. Any help is welcome, etc. And I think we're ready for questions. No questions. Yes?
So do you do some performance benchmark of Chromium? For example, how it runs on Fedora, Windows, and on Mac OS, or Debian, or other distributions?
Oh, you mean like a distro-specific benchmark, or part of the upstream development process?
Yeah, I don't know. I mean both.
Okay, so as far as I know, individual packages are not performance tested, but upstream has extensive infrastructure for performance testing every commit. We actually revert patches which introduce severe regressions, and it's all part of the continuous integration that upstream does. So yes, it's performance tested. It's not always perfect, but we're improving it. And I guess, you know, again, it's also something which is open source, and if people want to contribute to that, it's possible. You'll probably kind of need to ask around, like, where all of the pieces are, because some of them are, like, server side. You know, not everything lives in the browser itself. There's also, like, surrounding infrastructure, which is a different repo. Yes.
Is there a place where I can add some code repository with your work on, with your work in progress Chromium package for Fedora? Because the only Chromium code I found is like 2 months ago. So.
So, Don, do you want to answer that?
Chromium went into Fedora last week.
Okay.
So. You don't need to go copper anymore to get it. It's in there and it's current.
That's cool.
All right, next question.
What architecture supports Chromium in Fedora?
Right now, i386, x86, 64. I'm planning on doing the changes to enable ARM shortly.
32 bit or 64 bit?
It should be preferred either. Shouldn't be a difference.
And And is V8 the bundle, or it's?
V8 is bundled, because Google doesn't know how to make an API.
Yes, maybe a couple of comments on the V8 case. I used to actually package Chromium with V8 as a shared library for Gentoo. And I came to a conclusion, I could probably argue with like myself 1 year earlier about this, right? But I actually changed my mind and came to the conclusion that it doesn't make sense. And the reason is, both projects move at a very fast pace. And so remember, the release cycle is 6 weeks, right? And so there is like a very fast pace of development. And what they do, Chromium is their main client, right? So they do, V8 is actually rolled into Chromium a couple times per day. So the cycle, it's not the same type of cycle as you have with, GDPC, which is very stable for obvious reasons, or even GTK. GTK had, a lot of controversies with the recent, thing. They also, APIs are hard. That's the point. And the things they do in V8, they often like expose new APIs because they add new functionality to the language. There are things like that, and so they move very fast. And they can keep Chromium up to date as well very easily. The problem is there are other projects, say Node.js, which do not move as fast. And so you have something moving very fast, and then something that moves very slow, and trying to, and they're not willing to have big compatibility either, because that takes effort. And here is my point again. If it was important enough for someone to do that work, it's not a question that someone wants to break you. It's a question that people are not willing to do work they don't need to, right? And so if someone was willing to like say create a compatibility layer or something, and that's a non-trivial amount of work, then well, go for it, right? But someone needs to do it.
And how often are the other bundle pieces are updated? They are updated to wherever the upstream makes new release, or they are just sitting there till.
Oh, you mean in the Chromium code base?
Yeah.
There's a couple exceptions. I mean, most of them are just sitting there. But things like ICU are getting updated pretty regularly.
Yeah.
So it really depends on the component and the people that are working on the component. It's important to remember that it's not three people that are working on Chromium.
Yeah.
And so there's oftentimes 3 to 5 people that are working on each component inside of there, each bundled component. And so it really varies on what they need, whether there's a feature change. And sometimes what happens is what you see happen with ICU, where they didn't want to go above 52, but there was stuff in 53 that they needed. And so they were backporting stuff from 53 into the bundled ICU rather than push to 53. So it's how lucky are you feeling today with which component we can pull out?
Yeah, and in practice, I wish there was, and I'm also telling this, this is the idea, to have this two-way communication, right? Because, I also have similar talks at Google. And so, the whole idea is to actually bridge these two worlds, right? Because, here's an anecdote I can tell you that, from the other side, people were surprised. It's like, can you require that your package depends on like a specific version of some other package? Like require a minimum, it's like, yes, dependencies work, And people were surprised by this, right? So the idea is, there is a lot of just understanding of these two worlds. And in practice, what happens with the bundled libraries, they get updated where they need an update. Okay, so when there is like a security bug, and when there is, otherwise, I think nobody is motivated to like update them. And I wish we had a more distro-like process, which is like, okay, let's test this new version of the library, because
That was more like this, someone like checking for the security stuff and seeing and maybe looking into it.
They are, but some of it is because the bounty on security bugs in Chromium is. it's not a small amount of money if you find a bug in a security bug in Chromium, Chrome OS. So some of that is preemptive. We don't necessarily want to have to pay off this bounty that's aggressive in there. And also because the bounty is so much, there's so many eyes on that code stack. So even if Google wasn't being super aggressive looking at that bundled stack, there's plenty of other people that are looking for each one of those bundled codes to try to find a vulnerability that they can use to chain in and get Chromium credit.
All right, any other questions? Yes.
I wanted to ask, what's your opinion on the emerging bundling systems like Flatpak? Do you think it's something that can simplify distribution of Chromium to Linux users?
I don't know yet. There is certainly, you know, several alternative solutions. Like, I don't remember the Ubuntu one now. But there is also something else, right, which are kind of trying to do the same thing. So when it comes to packages developed by companies, say Google Chrome, it seems to me it could improve things, right? Because currently we provide, devs and RPMs, and they happen to work. We officially support Ubuntu, Fedora, maybe something else. But say there is Arch, there are other distros which are currently, you can't run Google Chrome there, which was also one of the reasons to get Chromium packages. And so Flatpak could ideally work in all of these cases, and this is something companies like Google could use to ship Chrome. For packages, like native packages, there still may be a room for that, unbundling libraries, codec handling. I guess we'll be figuring out. The idea is we don't want to create packages that people wouldn't use either, right? So the idea is that as long as there is a need, for this packaging work and people find it useful, we'll provide it, right? And a lot of that, interacting with communities, I also encourage, Chromium people when they modify libraries, like UBSB, Hanspel, and so on, to contribute these patches upstream, because then they will be easier to update in Chromium. That will stay. No matter how we package Chromium, this work of like connecting these communities, I think will stay, because we use 200 packages, and I'm sure there's lots of interesting things going on, with the combination.
I guess I'll ask my question. Is there any likelihood we're ever going to see the source code opened for Pepperflash? That's the number one most common request for Chromium package of Fedora is Pepperflash, because everyone just wants that.
Well, I'm not sure. That's a question for Adobe, and I've heard, given the amount of security bugs, they might not want people to look at the source code. There is a good news that Adobe now provides like a separate download from their website to get the PPAPI flash. You get a tarball. That wasn't the case just a month before. So it's like a new thing, and it's the best we have.
Yeah, no, I definitely want that link. Right now my script is pulling it out of Adobe.
Oh yeah, it's terrible. So that should make it a bit nicer. Yeah.
To compare performance between the bundled and the bundled version of Chromium, is there any difference in performance? Or
I didn't make extensive things. I wouldn't expect the difference to be that way, because we mostly have changes for sandbox and not for speed. There might be differences between Chrome and Chromium, because Chrome is investing more and more into link time optimization, profile guided optimization, where compile can take several hours. And so Chrome might be faster because it's kind of more optimized, possibly, than Chrome. I didn't do measurements, but I don't think there should be any.
So I did benchmarks 3 years ago to see whether there was anything conclusive. And one of the big changes between Chrome and Chromium when you try to debundle things is that you're using shared libraries. And so when you start using shared libraries, you get better runtime performance, but far worse optimization for launch times. At the time, 3 years ago, the performance focus for Chrome was how quickly can we launch the browser. and how much memory does it use when it's running, and not anything else. And those were the two main performance benchmarks they were tracking. Whereas when you put shared libraries in, it takes a lot longer to launch because it's loading a ton of shared libraries in to run. But once you run, you get better performance as a result of it. But it's
So it was my question. If someone like
but again, that's less about the debundling and more about flipping the shared library flag. You can get the same result without debundling at all by just telling it to build all the components of shared libraries, which is what we do with Fedora, even though there's not support.
But I think, you know, this is something a community could just, you know, say, write a blog post, like, I tried this configuration, this, and these are the results, you know. Say, I wish Chromium people blogged more. You know, one thing I like about, say, Planet Fedora, I actually read Planet Fedora regularly. Hey, it's interesting. Is that, you know, people just blog about their work, and not many Chromium people do. And I sometimes, some time ago, I encountered blog posts which compared, like, you know, commit rate in Firefox, Chromium, WebKit, Rust, and they did interesting analysis. Inside Chromium, we had a lot of discussions about that post. So, you know, when people just say, it doesn't need to be a big patch, you don't need to, it's like, I think it's a contribution event of some kind, you know, to have these measurements.
If anybody wants to help out with the Fedora Chromium package, they're welcome to come talk to me. I'm happy to have help.
I just reported the bug.
Fantastic.
It's precious stuff.
Which release?
Rohit.
Yeah, no, we know about that one.
No, but there was no bug, so
there are.
All right. Are there any more questions? Like, I'll still be at the conference today and tomorrow. If anyone has questions, I would actually be very interested. I'm mostly here for Chromium, not so much Fedora. Sorry. But if anyone is interested, you know, feel free to chat.
We should sit down and look through the patches that are in the Fedora package and see if any of them can get upstream.
Oh, yeah, exactly. If you have time, like, I would be very interested.
Yeah.
Anyway, no more questions for now? I think that's the end. Thanks very much for coming. Thank you.